What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. Project Lombok, a library I use and have been using ever since I found it. Just imagine you are writing your Java application, and you are creating a POJO, or plain old Java project. Inside this class, you have to create one or several constructors, getters and setters for your fields, a toString method, and maybe override the equals and hashcode methods. How many lines of code will you have to write to do all of this? Well, Lombok was created to help you get rid of all this boilerplate code. And the ones I just mentioned are just a few compared to the extents that Lombok can reach. In this video, I am going to cover several useful, easy-to-use annotations that Project Lombok provides to make your code easier to read and less error-prone. Before jumping into the annotations, I want you to take a quick look at the dependencies you will need to add to your Maven or Gradle project to enable and unlock the power of Lombok on it. Now, with this out of the way, let's start with something simple. Val variables. Val can be used as the type of a local variable declaration, instead of actually writing the type. In the example you can see, we are creating a map and then looping over the entries of this map without worrying what the types should be. Without Lombok, that is what the code producing the same output would have looked like. Note that adding val before a variable will mark it as final, meaning that you won't be able to instantiate it again. Which leads to the second feature provided by Lombok, and it is var. Var works exactly as val does, but the difference is that the variables we use var with are not marked as final, therefore can be reinitialized or assigned multiple times. This one is not used as much as val because Java already provides us with a var feature that does exactly the same thing as the one provided by Lombok. The first annotations we are going to discuss are the addGetter and addSetter. From their names, you can easily guess that these annotations will generate the getter and setter methods for your class. All you have to do is annotate the fields or the class you want with these annotations. The generated getters and setters will have public as default access level, unless you change it explicitly by providing it as an argument to the annotation, as you can see. The getter and setter annotations provide us even more customizations. The addGetter, for example, can be called lazily using the lazy argument if this argument is set to true for a particular field, in our case the data field, then this attribute will only be initialized when the getter method is invoked. In other terms, the initData method will only be called upon need so that the class can be loaded faster. Alongside the addGetter and addSetter, we can use the addAccessors annotation. This annotation will allow you to customize even further your setters and getters. In our example, we used this annotation to chain our setter calls one after the other, using the chain argument. We also used it to make them fluent, which means that the set prefix will be removed from the setter methods. This was done using the fluent argument. So, in our example, if after creating an instance of the actor class, we want to set its attributes or give them specific values, we can chain these calls, and these chained calls will not contain the set prefix. The next annotation is the addToString annotation. This one, you guessed it, will generate the toString method for the class annotated with it. In this example, we are generating a toString method for the same actor class we just had. What you can see is how the default output of the generated toString method will look like. Now, of course, just like the getter and setter annotations, Lombok also provides us with a few customization options for the toString method. One of them is removing the field name from the output of this method. To do that, you will have to set the include field names argument to false. This is what the new output will look like if you choose to remove the field names from it. Another thing you can do is exclude specific fields from this method. This is done using the addToString.exclude annotation on these particular fields. In our case, the ID field was excluded, which is one of the actor class fields. If, on the other hand, you would like to cherry-pick the fields to include in the toString method, What you can do is use the only explicitly included argument alongside the addToString.include annotation, and that will do it. This can be clearly seen in this actor class, where we chose to only include the name of the actor. Now, let's go ahead and create a person class. This class will be the parent of our actor class. The person class will hold the ID and name attributes, and the actor class will contain the top role attribute. We now have classes inheriting from one another. Lombok offers us the option to call the toString method of the super or parent class, or to exclude it whenever the toString method of the child class is called. This is done using the callSuper argument, and that is exactly what we are doing. We are setting this argument to true, so when the toString method is invoked on an instance of the actor class, the fields of its parent class or person class in this example will also be included in it. The at equals and hash code annotation is next on the list. This one will generate the equals and hash code methods, and its customizations are pretty similar to the at toString one. We can exclude a field using the at equals and hash code dot exclude annotation, and when excluded from one of the methods, it will and should be excluded from the other, of course. Now, to cherry pick which fields should be included in the methods, you can use the at equals and hash code dot include annotation. And finally, to enable or disable whether to call the super class when an equals or hash code method is invoked on an instance of the child class, we can use the call super argument as we did for the toString method. Let's tackle constructors now. Lombok offers three different constructor annotations: the @noArgs constructor, the @allArgs constructor, and @requiredArgs constructor. The @noArgs constructor will generate a default empty constructor for us, and the @allArgs constructor will generate a constructor that takes all the fields of our class as arguments. In our case, we will be able to instantiate an actor object by passing the ID, name, and the top role fields, or none of them. However, the @requiredArgs constructor will consider our final variables and variables marked as @notNull to be required, because these must be assigned to a value while creating an object based on that class. So these attributes are the ones that will make the arguments of the required arguments constructor. In this example, both the ID and name are required, hence a constructor having both of them as arguments is generated. This leads us to the @notNull annotation. Well, yes, this annotation, as you probably guessed, marks a field as required to be not null. What you can see is the code generated when this annotation is added. So if the provided variable is null, a null pointer exception will be thrown. The required args constructor we just covered will actually look something like this because we are using the @notNull annotation. The next annotation is the one I use the most because it is an all-in-one annotation. It is the @data. This annotation is a shortcut for the @toString, @equals and hash code, @getter on all fields, @setter on all non-final fields, and @requiredArgs constructor. By using @data alone, you will have access to all the features and methods that we previously discussed and that are provided by all these annotations. Builders quickly became categorized as boilerplate code, and Lombok, with the @builder annotation, also provides a solution for that. When you add the @builder annotation to a class, a builder will be generated for this class. What you see is the default builder generated by Lombok for the actor class. Notice that when calling the build method, it is returning for us an instance of the actor class. Now, a bunch of customizations can be applied to the builder generated. The builder class name can be changed using the builder class name argument, and the builder method name, the one we first call when we want to use the builder, can be changed using the builder method name argument. Similarly, the build method name can also be changed from build to something else using the build method name argument. On top of that, the access level can be changed using the access argument. And finally, the setter method's prefix can be modified, although by default these methods have no prefix. If a certain field or parameter will always get zero, null, or false, or its default value assigned to it, depending if it's a number, object, or a boolean respectively, which means that this certain field or parameter is never set during a build session. Then instead, you can directly specify this field as default by annotating it with @builder.default. Another annotation you can use alongside the builder one is the @singular annotation. If one of your class fields is a list, set, or map, you can add the @singular annotation on it, and Lombok will generate two adder methods instead of one setter method. One will add a single element to the collection, and another will add all the elements of another collection to your field collection. No setter will be generated to just set the collection, and a clear method to clear the elements of this collection will also be generated. Also, the prefix of the adder methods and the clear methods will be affected by the setter prefix argument we just saw. In this example, you can see a usage of the adder and clear methods generated by the @singular annotation. Now, what if we had two classes inheriting from one another? The person and actor classes, for instance. Does the builder provide us with a call super like argument for it? Well, no, it doesn't. And that is one of the downsides of the @builder annotation. And that is also why we have the @superbuilder annotation. This annotation works perfectly well with fields from parent classes. However, its customization possibilities are limited compared to the @builder one, and it requires all superclasses to have the @superbuilder annotation. The next annotation is about resource management. And managing resources can be a bit tricky, and of course involves a lot of boilerplate code in Java. Lombok is here to help you with the @cleanup annotation. This annotation will ensure a given resource is automatically cleaned up or closed before the code execution path exits your current scope. As you can see in this example, we are using it to close our buffered reader and buffered writer without using try with resources, nor finally clauses, nor close method calls. Finally, the last annotation I want to cover in this video is the @log annotation. This is basically not a single annotation, but rather multiple ones. As for every logging library or package, there exists a different annotation in Lombok. This annotation will generate a logger field named log, and its type depends on the logger selected, or basically on the annotation used. The list of logging annotations we can use is pretty diverse, so I am going to just lay it out there for you to see. Next to each one, I've left the corresponding package used for this specific annotation. Be aware that the use of loggers such as log4j and slf4j will require you to add an additional dependency referencing this logger, as this is obviously not handled automatically by Lombok. As you can see, this logger acts exactly like a normal one and can be used to call the different logging levels, similarly to what we are used to. To note that if a field called log already exists, a warning will be emitted by Lombok and no code will be generated. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.